You know, it's those things you like to hear when you hear that the city was good to work with. Those kind of stuff.
Okay, we will call back to order this evening's council regular meeting. We did the roll call. And at the time of roll call, Councilmember Taylor was not here. Councilmember Taylor is in. So we have a full council this evening. Will you join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You just jump out of your chair.
Easy. Chairs have a mind of their own. Okay, are there any changes to the agenda? Seeing none, we will move to approval of the minutes. The minutes from the study session of January 10th. Do we have any changes? The minutes from the regular session January 17th. The minutes from the study session January 24th. Okay, seeing none, all three are approved as submitted. And we will move to comments and reports. City Manager.
Thank you, Mayor. Since we're running behind, let me just a couple quick highlights. One week from today, we should have Wi-Fi here in the council chambers in the community room. Hopefully within the month, we will have, I'm aiming for the 21st council meeting, we will have a sample of an iPad and a laptop for the council to look at from a paperless packet approach. So we do have an iPad in-house here, so we're making progress and it's being evaluated. We're looking at the software pieces of that right now, and Wi-Fi is obviously a piece of that. But all the equipment's here, it's mostly in. So next Tuesday, we will be live.
I do have a quick question on that, and Kelly, you might be able to help. We have quite a bit of interference with this sound system when, with phones on vibrate and those types of things. Is there going to be some assurances that if we're operating with the Wi-Fi that we're going to be okay?
No.
Thank you.
So I don't know. I think we'll have to see. We've had several different opinions on what causes the interference. The latest occurred with the last round of problems with the sound system in here, and the sound engineer who came in from National Speaker and Sound said he's absolutely certain it's the 911 center that causes the interference and not the cell phones.
Okay. Well, we'll just see.
We'll see.
Okay. Thank you.
And our belief is that most people have their cell phones on, even if it's on vibrate. And so what we're talking about is a small incremental number of people who would be utilizing Wi-Fi as opposed to the normal data. So our hope is that it doesn't have a substantial increase. You're going to be at the end of this month doing your interviews for boards and commissions. We had a total of 26 applications, and we received more applications for each board and commission than there were spots. So you will have interviews and have an opportunity to choose from those folks. So that's great. And I can email out the details of that, or actually it's going to be coming before long in the packet. So we'll just do that. And I think in the essence of time, we'll leave it for now at that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. City Attorney?
I do not.
Okay. Councilmember Cole?
Two short things. I want to acknowledge there were a few problems with snow clearance and so forth, but on the whole, the city did, I think, an incredible job responding and getting the plows out there on that first day, and we've gotten quite a few phone calls and emails and so forth from people expressing their appreciation for that. So kudos to the Public Services Department, the crew. And then there were a lot of citizens who were out there helping each other too. And so I'm really wanting to encourage people to kind of look out for their neighbors. And if you have a snow blower, when we hopefully we won't have something big again for until 5-10 years. But anyway, you know, use that snow blower, help people, or somebody's temporarily or totally incapacitated full time, you know, give a hand if you can. And the one thing that people could do that maybe they haven't been doing, if you live near a corner, try to make sure people can get across the street and not have 3 or 4 feet of snow blocking the crosswalk or the informal way of getting across at a corner. Then for the city manager, I have a question, or maybe city clerk. Why, when mail is sent to the city center to each of us personally, you know, from a citizen or whoever, why is that opened rather than just sent to us direct?
I don't get the mail for the city council, but all the mail has always been, since I've been here, always been opened and either stamped or passed on.
And just, I mean, I've not received anything that I'm ashamed to share or for someone to know, but I did receive something in my packet last week, and it was copied to all of you, that article on the urban gardening, well, the gardening in the suburban areas, whatever. And I would have shared that or asked to have it shared, but it just makes me wonder whether or not it should be open if it's coming to a council member.
Well, I would say that all your mail is open to the public. And so when we open it up and it's a thank you note or whatever it might be, we copy it to all the council because all the council wants to know everything. And so we open everything and copy it to everyone. We can change that practice if that's what you prefer.
Well, I don't know whether or not citizens, when they send us something, realize that that's happening. And again, in my 4 years, I've not received anything that I wouldn't have felt comfortable with, but I don't know how the sender feels about it. That's my concern. So if anybody here or out there is listening, maybe they'd give us some feedback about it. Jim?
Yes, on March the 6th, I'd like to request that we have another late start. That is the Democratic caucus night. And I think that it's only fair that we do fair play with each of the political parties. So request a late start on March the 6th.
Okay, that's been done.
The budget discussions last year, we talked about having money set aside for South Suburban Park Foundation. I have talked with South Suburban about tree planting along the East Trail between the trail and Santa Fe. And they are taking a look at that area and doing a little analyzing to see what it's like. We've got church groups who have come in and asked for volunteer opportunities, and I think this would be an ideal volunteer opportunity, and I have talked with South Suburban about that. And doing a late spring, early summer planting, kind of patterned after the 10,000 Trees Project. And Alameda Nursery has offered to give us a huge discount on trees, and so we'll take him up on that. I missed the last Park Foundation board meeting because it was the same day as the Tri-Cities breakfast meeting, so I didn't get to go to the Foundation board meeting. Speaking of the Tri-Cities breakfast, we had the Area Agency on Aging give us a report that night, and what has happened since that time, Dr. Cog has set up 6 study committees. We've got over 80 citizens working on these study committees on various aspects of aging in the community. And they're working on a survey instrument that, when it is finished, will kind of give us the direction of where I think we need to go next. But right now, I don't see anything we need to do specifically in the city for our aging population, but I think the survey will probably point out some areas that we need to work on in the future. And lastly, I've been participating in a group that's called First Suburbs. It is a very small group right now looking at problems that first suburb communities have surrounding a core city. And there is a gentleman from Washington, D.C., who comes out to all of our meetings. We've only had three of them. Comes out to all of our meetings. He is working for an organization that's called Building One America. And he has contacts with staff members in the White House, and those staff members will be coming out to make a presentation in April. In the meantime, they are trying to get various elected officials and city managers together for a meeting with this gentleman from Building One America to talk about some of the concepts and things that they're looking at. And I'll be working with Michael about trying to set something up for us, and maybe we'll invite some of our neighboring cities along at the same time. So that's
okay.
It.
Okay, Bruce.
Thank you.
A word from our sponsor.
Let's see. Do you want to talk about the Trailmark Subcommittee? Do you want me to? You can do it if you want.
Okay.
I'll defer on that one. We, I think all of us attended the council breakfast at the Littleton Englewood Wastewater Treatment Plant on the 19th of January, where we reviewed the nutrient regulations, had a presentation from Steve Gunderson on the of the Colorado Water Quality Control Commission, and then as well as staff discussion and presentation as well, with the intent of essentially trying to head off at the pass some of the nutrient issues that may be impacting the plant and ultimately the rates paid by citizens and district ratepayers. Our city manager Penny, I believe, and acting city attorney Crawford then put out a memo subsequently providing information about a couple of bills that are going through the state legislature that would maybe lasso some of the regulatory enthusiasm that's out there as far as the Water Quality Commission is concerned. So we're interested in staying apprised of that. The Fire District, Littleton Fire Protection District Board meeting took place on the 23rd of January. Year-end financial review, the budget, revenue budget for the district came in a little bit light due to, I think, property tax underages, but expenses were further under budget, so all in, they came in ahead of the plan at the net level. They reviewed a variety of infrastructure issues at the stations, at their stations, which is normal, and then discussed as well the lease financing arrangement we're going to consider tonight with respect to a replacement fire truck and medic unit. There was also a question that came up, I think, from Chief Ireland about whether or not we're billing the district and the ranch for fiber optics to their stations, and I think the answer was from the district they didn't think that the city was. So I don't know, Doug Farman, if that got communicated back to you, but it might be worth investigating whether or not we're actually invoicing them for fiber optic capacity.
I don't think we are, but I will investigate that for you.
Okay, all right, thank you. And the contract is still, has it gotten passed through?
Not to us yet, but it should be to the district
from the ranch. Okay, all right, perfect. Let's see, I'll chime in on Peggy and just my kudos to public service as well as police and fire for their extensive planning efforts. Again, we know not everybody, you know, it wasn't 100%, but it was sure getting ahead of the curve on a real nasty snow event, and I think, broadly speaking, a heck of an effort on everybody's part and greatly appreciated. Lastly, of course, the often imitated, never duplicated, always loved and hated merchant plug of the week this week goes to someone you all need to know. Given how bad the weather is, it's very probable your car needs washed. My car needs washed. I'm thinking your cars probably need washed also. Therefore, you should seriously think about stopping by the Jazz Car Wash and Detailing Center, 6095 South Santa Fe Drive, 303-738-8885 or www.jazzcarwash.com. Not only will you improve the look of your ride in short order, but you'll also be doing something something good for the environment. As of the end of January, Jazz Car Wash has reduced their freshwater usage 80% by installing and operating a water reclamation system in its automated car wash tunnel. System will recycle the water used to clean vehicles, and the advanced system also uses the latest technologies to produce clean water ready for reuse. Newly cleaned water is just as effective as fresh water at cleaning vehicles, yet reduces waste. So let's see, Keith Taylor, nobody you know, is it?
Nope.
Okay. Is the owner operator, or you know him?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, good guy.
Yeah, actually went over there today and toured the new facility.
Nice,
yeah.
Excellent. Did you get a car wash?
No. It's a little cold.
I was meaning to mention that. No, anyway. But so there you have it, Jazz Car Wash. Stop on by and get your car clean. Thanks.
Jerry.
Great. I attended the Littleton Housing Authority meeting last Thursday. They did receive a REEX inspection from HUD, and that's the Real Estate Assessment Center, or Evaluation Assessment Center. They received a very high score on their property. I'm always happy to see that. I'm in that business, so I realize what it takes to get a high score, and they continue to get high scores. Littleton Housing Authority is also updating their website. They're going to provide more information. Some of the information they're hoping to improve on will be the rehab loan program that they have. It's low interest loans. In some cases, it's just an interest only loan for qualified folks in Littleton. Also, the Littleton Housing Authority is taking applications for folks that live in Housing Authority associated properties for student scholarships coming up for this summer and fall. And let's see, oh, and also they put out in their newsletter for the month of February, and I thought this was good, that February celebrates the invaluable contributions of African Americans to the culture and history of our nation. February was chosen in honor of the birth months of two who fought for freedom of American slaves, Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. I thought that was great. That's Black History Month, of course. And last but not least, never imitated. Please. I was just at East Elementary before the meeting here. They had their science fair tonight, and I talked to the principal of there, Greg Sumlin, and he was very happy with the support of the community. They had over 200 people show up for the science fair, and the kids were excited. There's some really neat projects over there. But again, they had more than 200 people, and the principal and all of East appreciates the support of Littleton. Thank you.
Thank you. Phil?
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you out to Steve Schaefer, who is the CEO of Health South of Colorado Springs. He drove up on Saturday to speak at the town hall session that we had at the South Metro Denver Realtor Association, and particularly given the inclement weather, it was great to have Steve there. For those folks that are present, they did have a brochure that talks about the facility that is being built down off of Mineral, and it's a state-of-the-art rehabilitation center that they like to refer to as a hospital. So the feds and the local folks always argue about some of that nomenclature. Possibly it's been mentioned earlier, but Mickey Kempf did send out another announcement. There is room in the CERT training, which is readiness training for emergencies, and certainly you can contact Mickey at bradfordauto.com. It's the Saturdays in March, and a call also goes out to those folks that might feel a little bit like a hypochondriac. If you're not able to participate in every one of the Saturdays, they are looking for folks that will be volunteer victims. But I think that's volunteer victim role-playing for the Saturday of March 31st. Tomorrow, the 8th, is the South Suburban Park and Rec District Board meeting. Their schedule tomorrow starts with an exec session at 4:30, a study session at 5:30, regular meeting begins at 7. On their agenda is a pre-discussion regarding the Stern Park dredging. A reminder that the public hearing for that is at the Buck Center, 7 p.m. This Thursday evening, the 9th. Also, we do have an upcoming combined breakfast meeting on the 16th with the South Suburban Park and Rec District Board, as well as the Hudson Gardens Board, so remember that team. Also, the Highline Canal Working Group grant applications are on their agenda, as well as there are a number of requests that they're considering from GOCO along the South Platte River. With regard to the South Metro Denver Chamber of Commerce, the Legislative Action Committee had an extra meeting this morning and also have another one next Tuesday, particularly taking a look at some of the economic development bills that are being proposed in the legislature during this particular session. Also, the a reminder that their Small Business Leaders awards are being given out on May 1st, so if you're interested in businesses, you might want to mark that on your calendar. Also, the Economic Development Group is having its breakfast meeting this Friday. What is interesting is both High Noon Entertainment is on, as well as the folks from the film segment of Economic Development from the state, so it's going to be a very entertaining breakfast meeting, I'm sure. And the Economic Development Group is now full swing with the business retention and expansion interviews that are occurring. And with that,
Bruce?
When you go last, all the topics I had have almost all been covered, but I want to talk about two that came up and then one that no one brought up. On the snowstorm response, I also want to say thank you to all the city staff and compliment them highly for dealing with what they say was the record for a February snowstorm, beat the previous record by several inches. I think it was great to see that the city made the tremendous effort to get a plow down as many residential streets as they can. A lot of positive comments about that. And, you know, council has created some goals, and one of the goals is to provide a safe community to live, work, and play. And I think that the effort made in the snowstorm certainly reflected that goal, and I want to say thank you to everybody for that. To add to what Phil has mentioned about the CERT program that Mickey Kempf of Bradford Auto, he's a great community volunteer who has taken this program and done wonderful things with it, also with the assistance of the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Department, who has the county responsibility for this. The CERT program was mentioned. It's an opportunity for you to attend four different weekends in March. You receive 32 hours of training, and it is for the community emergency response team. It gives citizens the chance to learn some skills that they could use to assist in the case of a significant crisis or emergency, and it's a very worthwhile opportunity if you have an interest in it. Mickey said today they had about 26 applicants so far. They're aiming for about 30 for the class, and they could go as high as 45 if they had to. And the city supports that by offering this building and some other resources for that program. Very worthwhile. The last thing that I did want to mention is I want to give a heads up that the planning is beginning for the next Littleton Leadership Retreat. In 1976, interested citizens in Littleton came together to create the first of the Littleton Leadership Retreats. Since then, there's been 22 of them. The planning has started for the next leadership retreat. The planners hope to put together an exciting and re-energized program for a date sometime in 2014, and the hope is to address issues that are important to the community and find ways to address those issues, combining the knowledge of folks involved in the schools, Littleton government, all the various community groups, and that kind of interaction. There'll be specific information in the next few months. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to be the only one that doesn't make a comment on the snow. I would like to acknowledge the way that the city staff responded to this most recent snowstorm. I think the departments work together very proactively to communicate and respond to the issue of the storm. It was clear that the community was definitely the beneficiary of these efforts. This is an example of raising the bar and setting a higher standard, which we should all expect and all of our citizens deserve, and I thank everyone who participated. And then in the interest of time, I'll hold my other comments to our next meeting, but I did want to make a general comment. There are a great many things about Littleton that are special. South Platte Park, our wonderful bike and walking trails, the Littleton Historic Museum and Town Hall Arts Center all come to mind. And it is because of one man's commitment, drive, passion, and love of Littleton that we all enjoy these treasures. Vaughn Gardner helped to make each of these a reality for all of us. Sadly, Vaughn died Friday, February 3rd. Great communities are built by great people. And Littleton will forever be blessed that Vaughn chose Littleton. There is no doubt Vaughn left his mark on this city, and a grateful community will mourn his passing. Vaughn will be honored tomorrow in a memorial service at Littleton's United Methodist Church starting at 1 p.m., and the community is invited. Okay, so now let's go to Dr. Cog report.
No report. We'll be meeting next week. We've just been doing committee meetings.
Okay. Citizen appearances. There's no one signed up for guest citizen. We have no scheduled public appearances. Is there anyone who would like to come down and speak to the council at this time on an issue that is not on the agenda? You're welcome to do so. Please come down and state your name and address. We have two cards, one from Charlie Sanchez. Is Charlie here? Did you like to speak?
Okay. My name is Charlie Sanchez. I live at 5931 South Greenwood Circle. It's a cul-de-sac, and I feel like I'm going to be throwing cold water on the snow removal project that you guys are talking so highly about. Like I said, I live at the end of the cul-de-sac. My neighbor to my right is elderly, and I'm getting there myself. But we had just completed cleaning our driveways and the sidewalks, and the city of Littleton, with one of the subcontractors, decided to plow the snow from Shepherd all the way to the end of the cul-de-sac and just drop it there, destroying all of the work that we went through. I talked to the driver of the truck, who happens to be a subcontractor, which I believe is Pioneer, if they were going to come back and remove the snow. And her comment to me was that she had to consult with the city of Littleton, who was conducting the operations along Shepherd. She went to talk to them. They left, and they left me with about 4 to 6 feet of snow in the entire bubble of our cul-de-sac. I made some phone calls to the public service department here. I left a message, which I haven't had a response to. And then after that phone call, I talked to Jerry. I called Jerry up so he'd come out and take a look at it. And he did. And I think he was pretty surprised as to what we had to put up with at that time. And as of today, we still have 4 to 6 inches, or 4 to 6 feet of snow at the end of our cul-de-sac, and I don't think it's ever going to get moved out. So that's what I come to say.
Sure.
I would like to thank you for coming down, Mr. Sanchez. I know it's difficult when we're sitting up here saying how great the city did do, and the city did do a fantastic job. I think there were some circumstances we can learn from, such as his cul-de-sac. When I did go out there, it was a driveway that was very difficult to get out of. He had to back down. I had to back down about halfway down his block. And I think it could have been resolved real quickly by that truck who was there. So while the city did a great job, I think we have some learning curves that we can go with. Thank you very much for coming down.
And we do have your information here, and we'll pass that on to our Public Works Department and see if we can get a truck out there and get that moved for you in the next day or so. You bet. Earl, I'm going to say it wrong.
Gunya.
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 there.
Bruce is supposed to help you with that kind of stuff.
I know. Well, again.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate the opportunity to bring a concern of mine in front of you. It concerns the consent item, I believe, you have on the tonight to approve, which is the licensing authority guidelines. I should make note that I am a member of the licensing authority, but I am speaking on my own. The authority was not provided the opportunity to review it, so this is my own major concern. My concern is that currently a violation comes in front of the authority. We have a show cause hearing, probable cause hearing. It could take 2 months. Your guideline adds another hearing in the middle of a preliminary hearing. So potentially, it could take 3 months from the time you have a violation until it's resolved. I think that is too long. I think somehow the process should be shortened. And I bring that concern to you, and I appreciate the opportunity to bring it to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Earl.
Okay, so is there anyone else who would like to come down? Come on down.
My name is Betty Harris, and I live at 6281 South Cedar Street. I don't have a complaint. What I have is a recommendation. Is there any way in the Littleton report we could encourage homeowners to clear the storm sewer drain when we have these kinds of snows? Because if those are blocked, then we have ice flows when it freezes and thaws. And if whoever lives near there could at least clear it a little bit, that would help with the drainage and make it safer for everyone.
Great idea. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, seeing no one, we will move to our consent agenda items. Consent agenda items can be adopted by a simple motion. All ordinances and resolutions must be read by title prior to a vote on the motion. Any consent agenda item may be removed at the request of a council member. Consent agenda item 7A is a motion approving the licensing authority guidelines. The licensing authority had a previous set of rules that conflicted with the council legislative rules that were adopted in January of 2012 and will apply to all boards and commissions. The revised guidelines include the non-conflicting previous rules and contain some additional information at the request of the licensing authority. The licensing authority desired to have a consistent format in writing outlining the procedures for the various hearings, such as probable cause hearings, preliminary hearings, and show cause hearings. Most of the information contained in the guidelines is set forth in state and local laws. One additional area that is covered in the guidelines but not mandated by state or local laws is the proposed penalty recommendations.
I'd like to ask that be pulled from the agenda.
Yes. Okay.
Please.
That's being pulled. Item 7B, city attorney, please.
This is a resolution approving a lease purchase agreement between the City of Littleton and J.P. Morgan Chase Bank for a medic unit and fire engine, and approving the city manager and finance director as authorized city representatives to sign the appropriate documents.
During the 2012 budget workshop, staff presented to council recommendations for replacing fire engine 11 and medic unit 13 using a lease purchase agreement with a financial institution. These recommendations were approved in the 2012 adopted budget, and the two fire units will be jointly owned by the City of Littleton and the Littleton Fire Protection District per the 2012 fire agreement.
I'd like to have that pulled from the agenda.
Okay, that's been pulled. Item 7C, city attorney.
This is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Littleton, Colorado, granting authority to the City Attorney to make minor modifications and non-substantive changes to agreements and other council-approved documents.
From time to time, City Council will approve documents and minor changes or non-substantive revisions need to be made after final approval. In the interest of efficiency, this resolution would delegate authority to the City Attorney's Office to make these minor modifications and non-substantive changes without seeking additional approval from Council.
I'd like to pull that one if we could, please.
Okay, that's been pulled. 7D, City Attorney.
This is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Littleton, Colorado, approving the Fourth Amendment to the lease from Wells Fargo Bank.
Littleton Police Department is requesting approval to lease space at Wells Fargo Bank for the continued use as a neighborhood police office as a Fourth Amendment. The lease is for Suite C in the building located at 89 West Littleton Boulevard. Officers meet and interview citizens in the building as appropriate. Some citizens in the area do not have telephone service nor transportation, and this office allows them a place to meet officers. Officers also use this place to complete reports and to have a break from their vehicle. Wells Fargo views this arrangement as a service to the community, and they have been very cooperative with the city. We pay only the lease amount to Wells Fargo and no utility cost. The lease amount remains at the same $1 per month. Okay, can I get a motion on 7D?
Mayor, I move that we approve consent agenda item 7D.
I second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Vote.
The motion is unanimous. The motion carries. The vote is unanimous.
Okay. Councilmember Taylor, you pulled 7A.
Yes. I have a number of questions about this, and I'm wondering if everybody's got as many questions as I have, if we'd be better off trying to set this for a study session. There are a number of what I think are changes in what we have been doing in the past, and I am going to have some explanation as to why some of these were done, but I do have a large number of comments to make about it, and I'm wondering if we might be better off just not acting on it tonight in the interest of what time, we already are, and have a study session about it.
Okay. City Attorney, did you want to make any comment on that?
Well, I don't think overall it changes much of what we've been doing. What it does is put some of it down in writing. I can highlight what is a little bit different, but in under your charter provision, section 53, it says that you shall, for your boards and commissions, create rules of procedure. And with this particular body, so much of it is governed by state law. It's an area that's heavily regulated by the state. So most of this is not something that you have a whole lot of discretion, nor is it a lot of it in our local laws. Where we have added two things is that we've put in there the fines in lieu. In September of 2011, you adopted an ordinance to allow the licensing authority to impose fines in lieu. In order to do that, local governments do have to adopt their own local law, which you've done, and so now we've put in place a process for that. So that is a little bit different. The other thing we've done is we've added penalty guidelines. There is a little bit of misconception right now that that means there's no discretion in the penalty that's imposed by the licensing authority, which is not the case. In fact, the guidelines would be more geared towards when the prosecutor comes forward with a recommendation as to how to resolve the case. She's going to look to these guidelines to recommend a proposed penalty, but that does not mean the licensing authority cannot exercise their own discretion as to what the penalties are imposed. So those new sentencing guidelines are in there for both liquor and medical marijuana. One thing that we did when we put those proposed guidelines in place, we ran them by the police department, who is fully on board with the proposals we've made, and we are completely in line with a number of jurisdictions when we set those proposed recommendations. The only other thing that we added, and this kind of goes to the concern of Earl Gunya, licensing authority member Earl Gunya, with respect to the time. Most cases have been taking a couple months to run through. Now there's times that things get extended and it's a little bit longer. And that is because we do a first probable cause hearing, and that's just to establish whether there's enough evidence to even go to a show cause hearing. What we did here is put one third step that isn't necessarily going to occur in every case but could occur, and that's the preliminary hearing, and that allows us to not call in every single witness and the expense of getting subpoenas out to, in the case of that we had recently, to people that were out of the city, and some of them were coming back unreturned. So that is just an intervening step that alleviates the need for bringing the witnesses in if a show cause hearing is not going to go forward.
Thank you. Councilmember Taylor?
Well, it doesn't make any difference to me. If you want to go through this tonight, we can go through it tonight. I don't care.
Okay,
my bedtime's midnight, so it didn't make any difference to me.
Councilmember Cole, did you?
Yeah, I did have a question.
Okay.
Has this been run past the authority?
No, we plan to give it to them once you've approved it. We did give it to them ahead of time, but not for comment, because this is really important that you understand that you set these rules. It's not really they're not a recommending body for this sort of thing.
I can appreciate that, but since they will have to follow it, if they have problems with clarity on something, it seems to me that's totally appropriate. And it's not like we need that there's a huge time pressure on this, so I suggest that this be floated past them. If they see something they think needs clarification, then that gives them the opportunity before we act on it. And I'd support Jim's suggestion of discussing this at a study session.
Barry.
Go ahead.
I just want to emphasize, I think, what our city attorney has stated is that the vast majority of these are not up for debate. These are set by state law. I think you all are cognizant of the implications of or the nuances of liquor licensing authority or law in Colorado, and obviously the medical marijuana as well. And it is not a situation that I believe we want to get into an argument or debate about the intent of the law or anything with the liquor licensing authority. These are rules that you guys are putting into place pursuant to state law. The attorney went through those items that are within your discretion or that are new, and the one in particular was the fines in lieu of, which the council just adopted. And so we had to put in parameters around that piece of it. And so the clarity piece, we can work with them on that from a process standpoint, but the basic fundamentals are taken from those state laws and put into place by our city attorney. And so I want to be clear that we're not, this is, again, the vast majority of this is not up for discussion, and that which is up for discussion should be discussed by the council, and then we will work on the implementation and the process by the board and commission. They are advisory in the items that come before them, and liquor licenses, more than any of the others, is very restrictive in terms of what the state allows to occur. And so I just want to be cognizant of, don't, if you have specific questions, and I would actually rather, if the council is amenable, hear some of the questions from Councilman Taylor so that we can address it, the attorney can address it from a you have discretion or you don't have discretion perspective, because I'm not sure that a study session set to state that you don't have discretion, you don't have discretion, you don't have discretion necessarily has value. So,
Jim, do you want to run a couple questions?
Well, I can do that if you have other people who want to talk.
Does anybody else have any? Do you have any?
Yeah, I do.
Jerry.
I too would like to go to a look at this at a study session, given the importance of it. And it may be just to make it more clear to me what it is. I don't want to feel like I'm just rubber stamping something. And I think this is a document that is rather important. So I would support this going to a study session.
Somebody want to make a motion?
I would like to make a comment, then I'll make a motion.
Okay.
In response to what Michael just said, I think that I read this as a layperson, because most of our licensing holders are lay people. Attorney may understand this, but as a layperson, I didn't. It wasn't clear to me. And I served for 4 years on a liquor licensing authority in another city. So I'm somewhat familiar with the procedures that go on. But when I read through this, there are points in there that are just not clear. It does not, it's not specific enough that to tell me where the intent needs to go or what the intent happens to be. And that's why I think that we have need to have a little more discussion and clarification about this. And I'd like to make a motion. We move this to a study session and let the manager and attorney determine at which date that will occur, however they look at their schedule.
Second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to move this to a study session date to be determined by... discussion?
Do you want to give them an example? Just, I mean, I think it'd be helpful if we had an example of what you're...
I can just give her my notes. Yeah. And
I'd be keen to hear what at least, you know, give me one example just so I get a better feel for what you're describing.
Well, for one thing, it talks about a presentation made by an applicant's case going to be cross-examined by the city attorney. That's fine. When it gets down to where the city's making a presentation, cross-examined by the applicant. That's fine. But then why is the city staff cross-examining the city staff? I need somebody to tell me why that needs to happen. And then there's a final rebuttal by the authority, and they won't have questions by the authority. The authority's had opportunity to have questions in all of these procedures up above. The cross-examining has happened in all these procedures up above, but yet when it comes down for final action, there's another opportunity for questions, another opportunity for cross-examination. It should be a discussion by the authority, and it should be then the authority either tabling the matter or continuing the public hearing or taking some sort of action. That's one example. And I've got a number of those that are just not clear as to what the intent happens to be. And I think we need to have some discussion about that.
So just one comment on that. That whole section there is taken from their rules that currently exist. So that is not a change.
So they're not clear, Kirsten. That's still my point. Not clear.
That's fine.
Any more discussion?
Well, Phil. Getting back to Earl's comment listening to the attorney, it sounds like that a preliminary hearing, which would extend the process to 3 months rather than necessarily what it would have been at a two-month process, it sounded like the attorney said there would not always be a preliminary hearing, at least when we get to understanding that, how frequently that preliminary hearing would be needed, what would actually trigger whether there's a preliminary hearing or not, in understanding that part of the process, so we could understand, you know, when is it going to take 3 months as opposed to two? Then you can, I'm just saying that's an item to address.
Any, Bruce?
Well, these rules are needed so that everybody knows what is required, what the black and white outcomes are going to be if there's violators, and how they can defend themselves. And it's pretty clear that if we're not sure, they're not going to be sure. So I'm supporting the idea that perhaps we need to have a study session for it.
Anyone else? Okay. Ready to vote? And this is a vote in favor would have city manager and city attorney create a date for study session.
The vote is unanimous.
Thank you.
All right, so 7B. Jim, I think you pulled that one too.
Yes. Okay. In the staff's report, in the very first line, it talks about during the 2012 budget workshop, should not be 2011 budget workshops. And then when you get down to the very last paragraph, the next to the last line, it says making recommendation to move forward with purchase of a replacement medic unit within the next 3 months. In the letter that went to Doug Farman, the announcement said that, as I was reading it, that the decision was going to be made by February 21st, or does that mean it could happen after that date? And when does a 60-month timeline begin? Is it on the time you sign the contract, or is it on the time whenever it's ordered? Is it on time when it's delivered? When's a 60-month payment scheduled to begin?
Good evening.
In the first paragraph, we call it the 2012 budget workshop because we were discussing the 2012 annual budget. That's why I referred to it as 2012, okay, even though it occurred in September of 2011.
I'm sorry, Doug, can you introduce yourself for the people?
I'm sorry, Doug Farman, Finance Director.
Thank you.
The the rate that you see in the five-year schedule, 1.73%, that is a rate lock that will be good until February 21st. So we do need to sign the documents, have everything to Chase Bank by that date. At that date, we would be obligated to make the first payment. So the payments are in advance. So every February 21st would be the payment date for over the next 5 years. And February 21st, 2012 is when the five-year clock would start ticking for the five-year lease.
And so even though we're going to start making payments this month, we won't even order the apparatus that takes 6 months to build, but we'll be doing it all in advance.
Right? We'll be doing it in advance. It'll depend on how long the vendor will be able to work with our fire department in ordering the two apparatus. And once we do make an order, they will ask us to make a down payment, which will come out of the $880,000 that we're asking the city to approve this evening. Okay. And so the Chase Bank escrow will reimburse either the city or they will pay the vendor directly for that upfront cost when we do make the order. Then when we receive delivery on the units, they will ask for the final payment. And that will also come through the escrow portion of Chase Bank. Thank Similar you. To what we did with the ladder truck a few years ago with the two other fire districts.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions? Okay, need a motion?
Well, you got C to do. Bruce pulled C.
Well, do we want to?
Yeah, but we're doing each of
do B separately.
I would move then that we approve consent agenda item B.
Need a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Bill.
Bill. Any discussion? Okay. Voting.
The motion is unanimous.
Okay. Consent agenda 7C. And I think, Bruce, was that you?
I did. I pulled that. I just had some process questions, and I thought it'd be helpful to understand from the start. Just from a process point of view, when we have an original version that we acted on and then a corrected version, how will those be maintained? Because one is archived as the action of council, another becomes perhaps the one that's actually acted on and becomes the one that is actually used, the instrument that's used. And I could see where the city clerk would have some filing issues, perhaps of keeping track of changes, and the state archivist might have some issues about maintaining them. So if I could just hear how that would work.
And so basically what, if there was an amendment that needed to be made, if we had a typo in a situation or something like that, the attorney would make that. Part of what we've got is we're putting into place is some scrubbing software so we can make sure that those changes are the historical changes aren't kept, and so we know what that final is. And then it would be the responsibility of the attorney to notify the city clerk of that final document. And so it would be an internal process for it. A lot of those documents, I think, that we're really talking about tend to be the contracts in particular, which are kept by the city attorney's office anyway. And so some of that would also occur internally. But there would be probably two components. One is, if it were a document that the council was interested in, flush that back through and make sure that you've got that final copy of it, depending upon what the change is. And then we have a fairly good, I think, internal process right now, because that it's not just on something that the attorney might make a change on. There's plenty of things. I think the downtown plan was probably an example that was approved, but there was a lot of other little cleanup pieces that were still going to be done, and we've got that process in place to make sure that the clerk is retaining the final document. And she's nodding her head that she's confident with.
You took it away.
I was just going to add that anything that would be changed under this would have to be re-signed by the president, and Wendy needs the signed copy, so that will help also.
Thank you. Those are my only questions.
Any other questions? Okay, need a motion?
Hold it.
I move the adoption of consent agenda C.
Second, someone?
Second.
I'll second it.
I'll give that to Bruce. Beckman. Okay, ready to vote? I know, which Bruce?
The Bruce.
Yeah.
The vote is unanimous. The motion carries.
Okay, so we are on to ordinances on first reading. These are all public hearings. 11A, City Attorney.
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, revising and repealing portions of Title I, Chapter 5, pertaining to administrative departments under the City Manager.
Under the City Charter, the City Manager has supervisory authority over various administrative departments. In keeping with the Charter, and to allow the City Manager to retain flexibility in the organization of administrative duties, the City Code needs to be clarified so that only departments that are required to be established by ordinance, such as police and fire, are established in such manner. For example, in 1971, the City Council created a Department of Public Health, Department of Emergency Planning, a Department of Public Works, and a Department of Public Library. These departments either do not exist or should not have been created and have duties defined by ordinance. As an additional issue, the Charter does not require the City provide by ordinance health services, which is an antiquated provision of the Charter which the City Manager intends to put on a 2013 ballot change, along with other proposed changes to the Charter that are administrative in nature. This is a public hearing, so let's hear from City Attorney or City Manager. Did you want to?
Several of the ordinances before you this evening are ones, as I've been discussing with the council, we are looking comprehensively at our code. This is an example of opening up basically the first page and saying, and so a lot of these first ones that we have, I was telling you before, there's some of these low-hanging fruit pieces. I think these are things we actually just tripped over. They weren't even hanging from above us. They were right there, and you'll see that it will start to coalesce, and you'll hear a lot more about that on February 10th. And so, and the mayor really summarized it well, I think, that the Article 7 in the Charter is really the core document, and how these or why these were created back in 71 is anyone's guess, but we'll address some of them, the emergency planning and a couple others, I believe, later. But just removing these and allowing the essence of the Charter to continue, there's no structural shift. It's cleaning up the ordinances.
Questions, Jim?
Michael, on page 3 of this, under the starting on line 7 where it talked about reports, I know you have put out information to us that you'd like to have a discussion about the reports coming to council and whether the I guess I'd call it the necessity to continue doing that. I don't think we've had that discussion yet, and somewhere before this goes to a vote of the people, I would like to have that discussion. Before we eliminate everything, I think we need to have a discussion about that, the reports.
This is an ordinance.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, before we vote.
Before the council votes?
Yeah.
Okay. So this does not change council's ability to direct or require the manager to do this. This removes an ordinance condition of that. Right? And so administrative or policy directive from the council, you can tell me that an expectation that you have is that there are monthly reports. What I'm proposing in this is to remove it from an ordinance. I'm not sure that that's necessary to be a statement of law as opposed to what is appropriate for the council. I mean, both in flexibility by the council's side and certainly working with a manager, because if a council decides they don't want monthly reports, at this point, you'd have to amend that. And again, as we've said several times, I think the norm of how this type of management is not handled through ordinances, it's handled through stated expectations from the council to the manager. So that was the intent
okay,
there, Jim.
Okay, that's clear.
Peggy?
It's not my intent to get rid of them.
I'd like to discuss some of this stuff in discussion, not tonight. A few of these are troubling to me to delete them. And I'm not thinking long discussion, but I do think maybe study session appropriate with several other agenda items. I mean, I don't see it long, but I'd like to talk through it a bit. And the one advantage of having something in ordinance is if you want to search for it on the city website to see if there's something related, you can find it. I don't know where directives are floating around, and if a previous council established a directive and then we're doing something, we don't necessarily have copy of that or know what's going on. So I think there's a larger concern with these.
So I would prefer that we talk. This to me is pretty straightforward. I don't know what we need to discuss in a study session. If I walk through these, there are the creation of departments, which by Article 7 are under the authority of the manager. The ones that we are not removing are the ones that are required to be created by the council via ordinance. And a lot of this, if you take as, and I'll be looking for an example from you, Councilwoman Cole, but 1513 is an example, preservation of records. We have a data by the state, we have a records retention policy that supersedes this, or certainly is duplicative of 1513. And so if we go through these, I think you'll see that the reason that they were being removed is either because it's in conflict with Article 7, not necessary, or it's been handled since 1971 in some other fashion. There's a lot of laws, court cases, et cetera, that have changed since then. So my preference, if council's willing, is to answer those questions and have the discussion now.
Jerry.
So just clarification for me, if you will. So essentially what we're doing, we're just eliminating the departments that are in the ordinance, but the functions themselves still occur in other areas.
Well, we don't have a Department of Public Health, obviously.
Right.
But yes, Department of Emergency Planning, that those functions are still there. We don't actually have, I guess via ordinance we do, but functionally there is no Department of Emergency Planning. We have staff and police and staff and fire that take care of those responsibilities. Department of Public Library, dual directorship, you know, just kind of going down these, Jerry, that's clearly, I mean, it's clarifying language, but it's already clear in the charter that the manager has administrative responsibilities, and if dual directorship is necessary, great. So
the bottom line is, then we're basically removing paper instead of being a government entity and adding paper. We're
correct.
Removing paper.
That is, yeah.
I like it.
That is it.
Bruce.
And you brought up the emergency planning, and I'm comfortable with eliminating this as you've recommended, because I can look to see an objective that we've included as a council objective that says to improve the city's ability to respond to emergencies and to update the city's emergency operations plan. So I feel comfortable that a very important topic like that is still going to continue in city business. It's just, I can tell you from experience, that was an archaic part of the code and was never actually done in practice.
And I mean, that's a good example, Councilman, because that's one where state and federal law already is mandating that if we want to qualify for grants and have availability of, I mean, there's FEMA responsibility that if we ever want to be in a disaster situation, we've got to have those processes in place. So there's enough other stuff out there. We don't, again, need to be duplicative in the situation because that system or that process is not going away. Regardless of what this ordinance says. So, thank you.
Anybody else have any questions? Okay, this is a public hearing, so we'll open the public hearing. If anybody wants to come down and ask a question or make a comment regarding this issue, come on down. Okay, seeing no one.
I move that the ordinance revising repealing portions of Title I, Chapter 5 be approved on first reading set for public hearing on February 21, 2012, and to be posted Littleton Center, Bemis Library, Municipal Courthouse, and City's website.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion, Council? Phil?
Yeah, in the comments with within this, I have no problem with taking some measures to eliminate antiquated language. However, what it does do is it says that this will need to be put on as a ballot issue. Do we envision that there will be other ballot issues in 2013, and what are the costs of those going to be?
Yeah, so this actually doesn't require, well, the charter does require the health services, but Councilman Cole has given me a fairly comprehensive list of some potential charter amendments. I've got a list, and I think the city attorney has a list as well. And so once we get to a place where we're prepared to come and have a discussion with the council, because it would be a referred measure if you are interested in moving those forward. And so doing a coordinated election, and we'll work with the city clerk to make sure that we hit those timelines and all. And so I would expect within the next couple months we'll have a full study session on those items to see what the legal requirement in terms of the number of ballot questions might be, what the council considers to be administrative, are there ones that you want to take on or off? And so if I can answer that in a future time in a more comprehensive manner.
Yeah, and if you can include in that, if we move ahead with the ordinance, what kind of time, you don't have to answer this question now, what kind of time frame do we have to put it on a ballot? You know, does it have to be 2013 if for some budget considerations the cost is not as attractive at that point in time, and either accelerating or deferring it would be something that would be more cost effective? That would be a consideration.
The city is required to have an election in 2013 anyway.
I understand that, but we don't have to have ballot measures. We do have to have election.
But there should be no increase in cost whether they are there or not.
I don't
know
that.
City clerk?
I don't know that.
Well, we will have an election in 2013, obviously, because we'll have council members up. It is more cost effective to have ballot measures attached when you're going to have an election anyway, because you are charged. All three counties do it different. So once we come to council and I see how long and how much they want to, you know, add to the ballot or have the council refer to the ballot, I'll have to get back to you on the cost. And having a coordinated election, being, as I've talked to many city clerks who have had councils want them to cost out to do a special election or to do it private within just the city, it's very expensive to do it outside, particularly because now, especially in off election years, they're doing 100% mail ballot elections. And those are always less expensive than doing polling places elections. And in 2013, in the odd number of years, most counties are going directly to all mail ballots, which is a great thing for a municipality because it saves us money also. So when I find out how many, Douglas County does it by the inch. Arapahoe County doesn't do it like that. So I will have to see how long it's going to be, and then I will give you a cost estimate when we have that study session. Or maybe after the study session when we find out what you all want to bring forward.
Bruce?
Can you explain, though, I guess, since is it not feasible to do what you just described this fall, since there will obviously also be an election? It can't be tailored or specific to just that portion of it going to Littleton residents, since
certainly certainly, that would be an option that council could.
So there's no real reason to wait to 13 if there's a need, if there's a desire to move.
No,
forward.
The only reason to wait for 13 would be to put it all on. We normally have an election in 2013, and we only have to pay for one election instead of two. So that's kind of the place where I'm coming from as the city clerk. For them, I don't know where they're going with it. I haven't been privy to that part of the conversation yet. I'm sure I'll be in there.
Yes, and to get to when we have the study session, be prepared to address this. It's obviously there's a fiscal implication. There's also it's a much bigger turnout when you have a presidential election, and so that there'll be lots of variables we will discuss. And thank you, Councilman. We'll be prepared to give you the pros and cons of the different options.
I have a question.
Peggy?
On the public health part, so if we have to deal with public health, this language at least allows the Tri-County health officer to fulfill that. So
No. We don't have a responsibility for public health.
I thought you said that.
We had an original charter requirement that had that, and I don't know what the situation was in 1959, but currently counties handle all public health related issues. In fact, I think there was a council member that made a joke about don't tell the county that we have this department because they might try to push responsibilities onto us. So it's a defunct.
Well, no. I hear that. So if the charter requires us to address that, it doesn't matter how we do it if only by defaulting to the county. So we don't need this?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes, which is why we'd be proposing a charter amendment, and while we're calling it an administrative change because it's not a substantive change to the fundamental operation or constitution of
we would change the charter.
Yes,
as
yes.
opposed to just having a little statement that we would keep that says the county correct. Would do it. Why not just do that?
Because
rather than change the charter.
Because we don't need the department. It is not a action that's municipal governments are responsible for under state law.
No, and I understand that. But, I mean, rather than changing the charter, though, if we just say that will be taken care of by such and such.
The council can discuss that when we discuss the charter amendments. I would argue that cleaning up charter language that is not useful is beneficial for clarity's sake. But that'll be a discussion because that is a separate piece of this process.
So if we repeal this, but the charter still says what it says, and we're not going to change it possibly till 2013. Isn't there a little gap?
Well, there's certain issues that override the charter, and the current situation with health overrides the charter. So we would want to eliminate it just in case anything ever changes in the future. No one can shove it back on us.
Okay.
Phil.
Just one quick item. I want to make sure we're clear in my understanding. Moving ahead with this motion does not commit us to a ballot issue in 2013 exactly, but that flexibility can be looked at. What will be most both effective and efficient from a communication and cost perspective?
Correct. This motion this evening has no bearing whatsoever on charter amendments. You are correct.
Okay, any other questions? Okay. And the motion is to approve the ordinance on first reading, revising and repealing portions of Title I, Chapter 5 of the City Code. And as everybody votes.
The motion is unanimous.
Okay, 11B. Kirsten.
An ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, repealing Title II, Chapter 1, pertaining to an emergency planning department.
With the departure of the deputy city manager, the city manager is looking at reorganizing administrative function, roles, and responsibilities. To this end, the city manager is desirous of retaining the flexibility of dividing and separating various departments and their functions and duties. City manager?
Yep. Thank you. Sorry, I think we had B and D confused there for a second. So we are on 11B, correct?
Right. Did I read the wrong?
Just,
no, you did.
You did good.
No, I think we're all set. And so again, if you look at, if you think about, what am I speaking to?
I know.
We have D, so we're going to have to go back and look at B. 11B is. Mayor, I'm going to read 11B by title. This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, amending the City Code Section 1-6-9 pertaining to the Municipal Court Administrator.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sorry. Would you like me to?
Yes. Right. I'm not going to read mine again because I read mine correctly.
Bingo.
All right. So again, referring back to the Charter and Article 7, if you look at the recommended removals under the Municipal Court Administrator Section 1-6-9, you will see that it has language in there relative to department head and essentially has a job description built in there as well. And so we are proposing a removal of the title of department head. The rest of that paragraph in what was 169A, the swearing in, that is a standard procedure, as I think the council is aware, that we do with all employees via the city clerk in there. So that, again, to Councilman Beckman's relative process question on the last item, there is a process in place to address that. And then we, as a general rule, have job descriptions for all our employees, and we do not need that to be in an ordinance fashion, so we have the flexibility to amend as appropriate. So the intent in here is that the original intent from the council, obviously, that the court administrator is appointed by the manager with the assent of the presiding judge, which I believe is a very appropriate way to take. We want to make sure that that relationship is good there, and then they will have such authority and functions as prescribed by them. So that would be the net result. So again, cleanup to Councilman Valdez's question on the previous one. This is removing language and just clarifying we have a court administrator. Here's how they get appointed.
Questions?
Jim? Just one comment that number capital B needs to be a strikeout, because we have just left a single sentence under court administrator.
Any other questions?
Public hearing.
This is a public hearing. It's currently open. If there's anyone who wants to come down and address this issue to council, please do so now. Seeing no one.
I move that the ordinance on first reading revising Section 1-6-9 of the City Code pertaining to the Municipal Court Administrator be approved on first reading, set for public hearing on February 21, 2012, and that it be posted at the Littleton Center, Bemis Library, the Municipal Courthouse, and on the City's website.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Discussion? No discussion. Ready to vote?
The motion is unanimous.
Okay, 11C. This is also a public hearing. City Attorney?
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, repealing Section 1-6-20 of the City Code pertaining to the Municipal Court Referee.
Currently, the review, prosecution, and dismissal of parking tickets are handled by the Municipal Court Referee, a position which was created by ordinance, which essentially delegated a prosecutorial function to the Municipal Court Administrator. Staff believes it's more prudent to have parking tickets handled in a similar manner as other non-criminal infractions, and that it is necessary to repeal this ordinance for that to occur. Kirsten?
Well, we are delegating here a function that is forcing upon the municipal court administrator to analyze law and facts, which has created some problems for us. So we just think it's more prudent to not do that. It's not necessary. It's not going to add any expense to the prosecutor's role.
Council, any questions? Seeing none, this is a public hearing. It's open. If anyone has any comments or questions of council, please come down at this time. Seeing no one, I need a motion.
I move that the ordinance repealing section 1-6-20 of the city code entitled Municipal Court Referee be approved on first reading, be set for public hearing on February 21, 2012, and posted at the Littleton Center, Bemis Library, the Municipal Courthouse, and on the city's website.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay, ready to vote?
The motion is unanimous.
Okay. 11D, this is also a public hearing. City Attorney?
An ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, repealing Title II, Chapter 1, pertaining to an emergency planning department.
In 2003, the city, in what appeared to be a symbolic message after September 11th, reaffirmed a dedication to emergency planning and adopted an ordinance for an emergency planning department and placed it under boards and commissions of the city code. Repealing this ordinance will have no adverse effect on the administrative efforts in this regard. Rather, this is another department that was not required to be created or have duties defined by ordinances. Michael?
I would just say, Mayor, that this is essentially a continuation of 11B. It was required to be done when Kirsten looked at it, when the city attorney reviewed it. It needed to be done as a separate motion and ordinance to take care of this section of the code. So it's you essentially have had the discussion.
Okay. This is a, oh, council, any questions? Peggy?
If we repeal this, Michael, there will be no code covering the declaration of an emergency, which is separate from the main focus of what the discussion is here. But it's in that section where it says how emergencies are declared and by whom, the conditions and so forth. And I think I brought that part of my code book with me.
Yeah, give us just a second here, Councilman Cole. Want to say it was under the manager section that it has.
It's in 219.
Of the ordinance, right? Let us review the charter here real quick if you don't mind, because I think the charter speaks to it. Charter.
Let's see that.
No more merchant plugs.
Actually, I've got a spare one.
Oh. I don't have a floor.
So I think there's something in the charter that we're not finding right now, but we can certainly take a look at that and bring it back to you.
Any other questions?
We want a table.
Okay, this is a, we've got a second hearing. Yeah. Okay. This is a public hearing. If anybody has any questions or comments for council regarding this, please come down at this time. Seeing no one, can I get a motion?
I move that the ordinance repealing Title II, Chapter 1 be approved on first reading, set for public hearing on February 21, 2012. And at that public hearing, the city attorney and city manager be prepared to identify how emergencies are declared at the city, and that the ordinance be posted at the Littleton Center, Bemis Library, the Municipal Courthouse, and on the city's website.
Get a second?
I'll second that.
Bruce Stallman second, and Ms. Bruce Beckman. I knew I was going to do that one of these days. Everybody vote. Okay.
The vote is six in favor, with Councilmember Cole voting no. The motion carries.
Okay, 11E. This is also a public hearing. City Attorney. Keep up.
Sorry, I was still in my charter. This is an ordinance on first reading repealing section 1-4-5 of the City Code relating to liability of officers.
The liability of officers of the City of Littleton is governed by state and federal law. Disciplinary issues pertaining to administrative staff are solely within the purview of the city manager pursuant to the City Charter, Article 7. This provision of the City Code could be interpreted as waiving governmental and qualified immunity defenses, thereby exposing officers and the city to liability and damages. Michael or Kirsten? Kirsten?
So this was another provision that is, it predates a lot of changes in the law. There's a host of laws, federal and state, that govern liability of public officials, and the list is numerous to kind of enumerate for you. But just for example, the Colorado Governmental Immunity Act, the bulk of it came after this code provision. So the concern here is you can, by code, decide to waive liability. I don't know that anyone would ever deem that prudent, but it's important to get this section of the code out repealed.
Okay, any questions, Council? Jim?
I got two things. Who is considered officers of the city, and are city councilors considered officers of the city?
Yes, the way I read this would be any public official elected, appointed, or otherwise.
Any other questions? Okay, this is a public hearing. If there are anyone who would like to come down and address council on this issue, please do so now. Seeing no one, can I get a motion?
I move that the ordinance repealing section 1-4-5 of the city code be approved on first reading, set for public hearing on February 21, 2012, and that it be posted at the Littleton Center, Bemis Library, the Municipal Courthouse, and on the city's website.
You a second?
I'll second.
Jim Taylor seconds. Council, any discussion? Okay, ready to vote.
The vote is unanimous.
Okay, 11F. This is also a public hearing. Kirsten.
This is an ordinance requiring certain standards for signage for parking on private property.
This ordinance provides minimum standards for signage or pavement marking designating the property owner's provisions for parking on their private property. Title 9 of the City Code provides for a property owner to prohibit or allow parking on their private property provided the rules are stated on a sign. There are no requirements of where or how that sign is to be posted on the property, which may cause confusion for the parking public. Kirsten? Oh, Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As you mentioned, we do provide for a private property owner to allow or disallow parking on their property as long as it's stated on a sign. But the existing code doesn't state what the rules are of how you post that on the sign or how you pave it or paint it on the pavement of the parking space. So that's what the amendment of this ordinance is for. We're also providing for a phase-in period. So we're recommending that there be a 90-day period where we'll notify all the property owners out there who are allowing or disallowing parking that there's new rules in place, and they'll have to be in compliance in 90 days. So with that, we'd be happy to answer any questions for you.
Jim?
Well, first of all, I'd like to see this public hearing moved into March. There are an awful lot of very small businesses in my council district who have anywhere from 4 to 15 parking spaces, and particularly in the downtown area where they're open only from 8 in the morning or 10 in the morning to 5 in the evening. And I think there needs to be some kind of provision that they can have or can allow parking on their lot in the evening. And this, what's proposed, doesn't address that specifically. And secondly, an awful lot of those lots in the downtown area are moving to paid parking. And how is that going to address this? So I'd like to have the opportunity to at least present this to some of the people who may be affected by this parking and get some publicity out as to this will be a public hearing dealing with this issue, but it needs to be in March to give them notification time.
Michael?
Follow-up question, Councilman. This isn't about implementation piece. This is about making sure that it addresses concerns from the property owners. Because if it was about implementation, the council could amend the implementation date from the 90-day that Glenn spoke to a different period. I just want to make sure I'm clear on the request for the hearing.
I'm just looking at the sample sign that you gave in here, and if that's the sign that goes in, then if a lot owner wanted to put paid parking for the restaurant use at night, mm-hmm. who is a half a block away from the big restaurants, doesn't allow it. And so I want to have some opportunity for them to weigh in and say, wait a minute, you're prohibiting me from making money on my lot at night. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, and again, there's nothing in here that we intended to disallow somebody to charge for their parking. It just has to be stated on a sign. And the lettering has to be a certain size and has to be somewhere that can be seen.
But if a law-abiding citizen pulled into a parking lot and parked right in front of this sign, a law-abiding citizen would move their car because it says violators are not allowed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I think we need to take a look at.
Okay.
Bill?
Two things. One is I echo Jim's concern that we extend the time allowed for public comments or hearing, possibly even some communication like with downtown merchants, particularly that something would be there. But my other question is, we have homeowners that have driveways. They typically don't put a sign that says, don't park in my driveway. How does that get addressed?
That's actually, I believe, a separate section that says you can't park in somebody's driveway. Again, without it being posted, somebody allowing that. So actually, and I don't have the section in front of me, I believe that is actually addressed separately from a residential standpoint.
Okay, it's somewhere between now and when we have the public hearing. Getting some confirmation and reference to say, hey, if you're talking about a private residence, something that's obviously not public, I could post, you can park here for $10 or something like that. But, in general, if there's a prohibition against driveway parking that's not identified,
that would be trespassing, yeah.
Well, I want to make sure this doesn't usurp some of that.
All right. I will say we did look at the downtown, and we looked at most of the parking lots that we could see. There were very few that were not in compliance with the rules as written now. But
Bruce?
We'll go back and touch base with them, sure.
Yeah. I guess maybe just for context, so what sort of precipitated this problem or brought it to your guys' attention as being one that needed correction? I've got a couple other questions, but I'm just curious as to...
If I can address, and I think Councilman Cole has a comment. We have received, in fact, I just shared with the letter with the mayor today that where somebody had been towed pulling into a parking lot, a private parking lot, it was towed legally. But there is, as Glenn mentioned, there's inconsistency in the signage on private property. We have no consistent language. So all this ordinance was intended to do is create that base consistency and location, size, and text for it. So it is not to respond to Councilman Taylor's, you can add other information onto it if you want to have the paid parking, but it's to create that base expectation so that citizens or visitors coming into the downtown or other locations are hopefully more cognizant and aware because the signage is consistent.
Okay. Do you have
a picture too of
huh?
I have a picture of, I gave you a good example, but I also have a bad example.
Oh, bad example.
If you're interested.
Yeah.
Can we put it up or should I just?
While you're doing that, how many properties do you anticipate this applying to? I mean, is that, how many properties are we talking about being affected by having to change signage citywide ballpark?
Actually change signage?
Well, either put something up if it's not there and they want it there, or change something that's there that's not in compliance.
Councilmember, I couldn't give you a good guess at this point. We did run through and did a cursory review of the downtown in particular.
Yeah.
But there might be other places in the city where they have requirements. I'm thinking Aspen Grove. I didn't go through. I think Aspen Grove has something about parking in their parking lot if you're riding the RTD. Facility. I haven't looked at that, so I don't have a really good guess. This was, I think, the example that precipitated the issue, and you can't read the lettering, but it's certainly about 12 feet high, and I think that was the concern, so.
Can I explain this one, because I'm the one that started this mess?
Sure, yeah.
Three people on one night got towed from this place.
What is this, an apartment?
No, I don't know what this is the back side. Just to our left is Curtis, and
Curtis.
This building fronts on Main Street, so we're seeing the back of a building on the south side of Main Street.
Okay.
And then okay. Curtis is to the left. And three people were towed the same night. And I forget how much I told you. I think it was a couple $100 or more than that it cost to get their car back when they were towed. Well, he told you the height there. There are several, this is a huge area, and the building goes across nice and straight. Then there's a different kind of shape. And then the backside of a building that comes way out this way, and then there's a building behind, and all of the other places had signs that were just about at eye level, but this one is way up, and apparently the folks that got towed weren't looking up. They saw the other eye level signs, do not park, so they parked facing Curtis. And there's no sign there, and they come out and their car's gone, and they called the police to report it being stolen and discovered instead it was towed up into Denver and so forth. And they paid a chunk of money.
Sure.
For that. And so I went down and looked at it. I took pictures too, but I reported it, and I said, it seems to me that this is not a fair way to tell somebody you can't park when the sign is way up and you wouldn't be looking up for that sign. And okay. So I asked them, would they look to see what other folks do and what might be done so that it's more fair playing field for people who go down and spend money downtown.
Well, I mean, that's two issues, though. I mean, you've got the nature of the sign itself, but your issue is more one of placement, and I don't, is that somewhere else?
And that's, that was an issue I was going to ask you about, Glenn. The item three, that they're located so as to be seen by an ordinary observant person. Some people would say, well, person would see that, so it seems to me that needs to be tightened up in some way, whether it should be no more than so high or, you know, I don't know, but
so big,
yeah, a little more direction, I think, on defining what that would mean?
Something closer to eye level, for instance. I hate to put a dimension on it because it,
yeah,
there's just so many variables. And I think most of the codes we looked at tried to keep some flexibility, but...
they could argue that that's in compliance with your language, couldn't they? It's a pretty big sign. I mean, I get Peggy's point, but...
Well, at night, when you go in and your car lights are going straight,
right,
you're not looking up 12 feet.
It's a fair point.
That was what happened to them. They thought they were totally okay.
How many of these things, too? Because, I mean, if you've got a lot like... Oh, Greg Reinke's lot is a big lot. I mean, how many of these signs need to be posted where? Because he could have one sign that's... I understand this is maybe getting a bit of far afield because you're talking about just the nature, what the sign looks like. So maybe there's other areas of the code that talks about how many per number of spaces or some such thing. I don't know.
And can I just interject that the reasonably observant standard is really common in the law? So that's there to account for all sorts of things. So when a court would be looking at this, they know what that means.
Actually, that came up in discussion and reviewing legislation. Reasonably, it seems to be pretty well understood in Colorado. Ordinarily, this is the first time I've come across that. And so using the term ordinarily, I agree with Peggy. I'm not sure. Reasonably, I understand because that's been tested in court here. Ordinarily is...
That's fine. We could change that reasonably. I agree with you. That'd be better.
Bruce?
Glenn, I think this is the tip of a really difficult to deal with iceberg with the parking problems and probably needs a little more comprehensive look. I know in the past from my experience, the judge was the one who in just simple parking matters, when a ticket was issued, had to make determinations as to whether the person should have known better. And it was a very subjective standard. So clearly there are problems and with it, but I have to say that there's a predatory culture out there that has to do with towing. And when we begin to look at the issues that we're dealing with now with towing off that property, I think it is fraught with problems. The industry itself, there are folks who make a lot of money towing vehicles from private property based on some signage of some kind. And I think we need to be really cognizant of that issue when the towing's involved. And then also, I want to reflect the idea that the property owners need to be involved in this because this is something they're going to deal with, and I think they want to have a voice in the solution, whatever that solution is. And then finally, I want to say that the one problematic statement is that some property owners with non-conforming signage will have to bring their property into compliance. And I understand that because of what I just said, but now we're creating the parking sign police, and so I'm not sure that we're prepared to do that without some additional discussion.
Kirsten?
I'll just add one thought on that. We're not going to put this in the sign code. It's going to be in the traffic code, so we're not going to be in the practice of enforcing the signs. It's more so that they can be reasonably ticketed for their improper parking.
Jim?
I guess two things. Marks on the pavement is new, and our experience in the past few days, if they had marks on the pavement, they couldn't see it. even when it began to melt, it was pretty sloppy. So I'm a little bit concerned about that being the only sign there, that there may need to be a sign in addition to the fact that there's marks on the pavement. And secondly, if we're going to have all this required of all the property owners in town, is it possible that the city sign shop can construct new signs at cost instead of them having to do that? We're paying the employees anyway, so if we get reimbursed for the cost of the sign, have the city consider making the signs so they then become standardized when we're doing it? Something to think about.
Certainly.
Jerry.
How bad is this issue?
As I mentioned, we put the ordinance together. We did a cursory review of the downtown because that's certainly where it's most prevalent. This was the one site that seemed to pop out at us as not meeting the intent of this ordinance. There could be others, though. I can't say we've hit every property.
But it seems like if that's the problem for at least three cars, I mean, anytime you park behind where the building's down there, you got to have a clue that I may be getting towed if I'm not supposed to be parking. And you look around. Now, if this one particular property is an issue, why don't we just say, hey, why don't you lower your sign? Let's just try asking them to lower a sign. Because right now we're asking everybody to spend money because this guy has a sign that's 12 feet high. I mean, why don't we just take a more friendly approach here? And I think the timeline of asking everybody to change their signs and the cost within 90 days, I think is just unreasonable. I would rather just say, hey, ask the guy to lower his sign.
Mm-hmm.
And ask people to be a little aware. Look for signs, man. I know when I go anywhere, I always wonder if I'm going to be ticketed or towed.
Right.
So I think the driver of the car is on some responsibility, too. I think $200 is a heck of a lot of money for sure to be towed. But if the issue is really only this one particular property, why don't we just talk to this property instead of asking everybody to pay?
And I don't believe that it is just this. As I said, I mean, we just received another letter or a letter today. Dealing with a different location for it, and what you guys are struggling with is that balance between the driver's responsibility, the business's responsibility to make aware, and where is the government's role in that to create that balance? Because we want a situation where people, I mean, the typical letter we will get is, I got towed, and therefore it's Littleton's fault. Littleton is unfriendly to visitors, and we're going to go eat at a restaurant somewhere else. And so what is the balance between us taking, as the local government, taking an action, which in this case is an attempt to have standardized language, you know, the standard kind of entry sign into a parking lot that says this is private property, you know, enter at your own risk, you could be towed, with additional costs for the businesses out there and the responsibility of the business owner. And so that's the challenge that you guys are struggling with right now is what is, because we can certainly call up the one business if they say, hey, you don't have an ordinance, we're going to keep it right where it is because I don't have a ladder to lower it. But this is a standard, this language is standard in a lot of municipalities, and I would say probably most municipalities. We were able to get plenty of examples in here. So it is that balance that you guys are struggling with. I mean, if you listen to the conversation you're having.
Well, I think exactly the example you just gave that, you know, if people will go shopping somewhere else, well, I don't think it would take our downtown merchants long to figure it out that people going somewhere else because of the parking situation. And I think it's a something that I think the property owners and merchants down there can fix.
And I'm not, the government whichever way you ultimately want to go. I mean, I think you heard from Councilman Beckman, there are people who make money off of this. And it's one of those, if there's enough people continuing to come downtown, you may not necessarily see that, but the one person tells the 10 people that it was an unfriendly situation. And it's a lot easier to keep existing customers than it is to go and recruit new customers. I mean, there's plenty of stats on that. And so the pent-up demand, if you will, may continue to demonstrate that that we're full. But if, you know, are we making a statement, and this is a larger conversation to Councilman Beckman's comment as well, but are we making a statement saying we're open for business, or is there a way that we can relatively easily help our visitors and guests who come down, who may be coming down at night? I mean, and I'm not defending somebody pulls into a obviously private lot and gets towed, because you do have to use common sense, but where is that balance, and does this help you?
The answer is yes, we're open for business, and if we have predatory tow truck drivers, let's deal with the tow truck drivers. There we go.
I mean, they're allowed to tow when somebody's parked where they're not supposed to be. And
this is an attempt to help the driver be cognizant of the violation.
I have a question. I recently had a conversation with a citizen who they actually, part of their HOA operates a kind of a community center for the apartment or condo group. And they have a parking lot in there, and they've had some problems with people who are parking in designated handicap spaces. And they called the police to have the police tow those cars, and the police said that they couldn't tow those cars because the signage was not enforceable. And so what they then described was that if you are going to have handicap places, you have to have a specific signage for that. And they gave the description of what was needed for that community to do. And then you also, if you are going to tow, you have got to list that your vehicle will be towed, and this is who will tow it, so that they know who's going to tow the vehicle, so they know where to go get it. So if we've got the police with those types of laws and rules that on private property, that they can't do anything unless it's properly signed for them to do something, are we cross-checking on this so that what they're saying and doing and what we do here is all going to be the same thing? Because if a citizen calls again and wants to know, we could have two separate answers, and we shouldn't. We need to have one.
Right, right. Yeah, and we did look, and I don't think our ordinance discusses standards for parking and what it shall say. This is really the only section. So maybe the officer is giving a best practices recommendation to that owner. I'm not sure, but that was one of our concerns, is there's really what you see in the ordinance previous is all it says. It shall be a sign, and that's basically it.
And the only addition to that is that we've adopted a model traffic code, 2010 version of the model traffic code, and in there it covers handicap parking. I don't think there's a signage regulation to the extent that you have, so we have looked at that, and I think Glenn might be right. It might just be that that is kind of a best practices.
I would encourage you to speak with the command staff and get some clarity, because I'm now hearing two different stories. So
handicap parking, I will say our building code has the ADA standards that are adopted in there, and it is very specific about how the spaces shall be signed.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they could be using that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But I would say that the intent of what we're trying to accomplish is very similar.
Mm-hmm.
You come into this parking space, you come into this lot, here's what can happen to you. So that intent is there, and if we haven't gone far enough, then we can certainly return with additional detail. But you're absolutely right. That specificity and that level of clarity, here's the action that will occur if I choose to be here.
Okay. Jim.
One question that I'd like to make a motion.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, if you already have the ownership that's going to be notified about the 90 days, would it be feasible for council to get the input from property owners by notifying them the properties when the public hearing is going to be? That they get a postcard saying, we're going to be addressing signage for your parking lot on this date, it'll be a public hearing. Just a simple notification like that, if we've already got their addresses. That's just a question.
We don't have all their addresses today, but we could have them if you want to extend the date in the next 2 weeks.
Well, I'm going to move that we approve the attached ordinance on first reading and a public hearing date be held on March the 20th of 2012.
I need a second.
Second.
Okay,
we chose that date because that the Merchant Association meets after the first meeting in March, and I really would like to have the opportunity to talk about that at the Merchants meeting.
I stepped out of sync on this. This is a public hearing.
Oh, sorry.
I know, that's okay. Is anybody in the audience who wants to weigh in on this? Now's the time to come down and address council. Seeing no one, Jim, would you please make your motion again, just including the closing of the hearing?
We'll close the public hearing and recommend approval of the attached ordinance on first reading. Public hearing date be held on March the 20th, 2012.
Second.
And we have a second. Okay, so Hearing is closed. Council, any discussion on the motion? Bruce, and then Jerry.
So you've got staff is proposing the ordinance be implemented 90 days, which is basically just in the staff communication. So there's really nothing to amend other than, I mean, if we really said, well, hey, we'd, you know, prefer to implement it over 180 days, we could just say that. I mean, but, I mean, to Jim's point, I think it makes sense to get feedback, you know, get stakeholder input here and try to sort of phase it in over a longer period of time, I guess.
Councilman Stallman, Section 2 references the 90 days.
Does it?
So it's it is in the ordinance, but that can be changed, but it just to let you know.
Oh, I missed that. I'm sorry. Thank you. Good.
Jerry.
Okay, well then.
You could change it on second reading after Councilman
Fine.
Taylor brings back
okay.
his
okay.
comments from the downtown merchants, which is your intent, correct?
Thank you, mm-hmm. Councilman Cernan. Appreciate that.
So Jim, I just clarify. All we're doing is just taking this, moving it to another date to give the merchants
yes.
a chance to hear about this, if nothing else.
Not necessarily merchants, because there's a lot of little small car repair shops in my district, in the downtown area, that have got parking that could be utilized.
Well, for instance, there's nothing that if we voted this down tonight, there's nothing that once it got back to the merchants could come to the city and say, yes, we would like to have a standard signs.
Could. I wouldn't anticipate that, but they could.
Well, if they didn't do it, it's because they wouldn't necessarily want it.
Any more discussion?
I feel like we're forcing an expense on people and it may not be necessary.
Okay.
We're voting on?
We are voting on the ordinance requiring standards for signage for parking on private property. It's a first reading. This moves it to a second reading on March 20th, 2012. Okay, ready to vote?
The motion is unanimous. I mean, the vote is unanimous.
Okay. Sorry. Seeing no more business, we are adjourned.
All right. Oh, it's so good to be back. Yay. Hey, how was your